ever think about substances like metals or crystals becoming conscious? Some people do. They actually think that not too long in the future we will have computers that are conscious. I actually think we already have materials that are conscious in a way. Now, in my hand, I have a phone. We use that all the time. This consists of materials like silicon. With the notation, we call them semiconductors. But basically, it's silicon. I mean the stuff that's inside that does the actual information work. On this side, I have a big crystal. Now, what's the difference? Phoning on silicon, phoning on silicon. So the main question that I have about crystal is it conscious? Can we do things with it? Now, in order to be conscious, you have to have memory. Like the little phone I have in my hand. I mean, this already has, these days, a couple of gigabytes of memory. And that on a very little sheet of silicon, the semiconductor, CPU and memory in there. Here I have a lot of crystal. How much information could I put in that crystal? Now, this sounds ridiculous, but all through the ages, people have used crystals, diamonds, to kind of connect with. Information can be put into the crystal and taken out of the crystal. So, for me, the first step to consciousness is memory, and crystals are a step towards that. Gold. On my hand I have a little piece of gold. It's called a nugget. This is the form of gold you will find in nature, in the rivers, in the mines, and it's not totally pure gold, there's some other metals there, but this is the purest we find in nature. Now, I believe that gold has some very special qualities. Qualities that refer to the thought domain. To put it plainly, I think gold and brainwaves, thoughts, are related. That gold has a function. In that respect, think about crowns or priests having clothes that are woven with gold threads. Well, we know in many religions a gold crown is in some way used. For instance, in the Hindu religion, when you marry, you need to have a crown over your head. So crowns, in fact gold, and brainwaves have a relationship. Just think about it. Why would that tradition be there? Well, my solution is simple. Gold, especially this kind of gold, which is pure gold, but gold in general, will protect from brainwaves. So, if you have a crown over your head, the brainwaves from other people will not get to you. You're not going to think what other people want you to think. You have to think for yourself. That's why a king has to have a crown. That's the function of it. It actually protects him from other people's thoughts, from other people's brainwaves. And this is a function of gold that is not usually known. Gold is, as an element, as a physical element, very important. It has nice qualities, electricity, it doesn't rust, it's very resistant, it doesn't oxidize. But this quality, gold and brainwaves, for me, is why gold is so important. Who am I but my friends in me? When I look around at the people around me, I'm actually seeing myself. I'm seeing reflections of my own behavior. I see resonances. What I am is in them. Who am I but my friends in me? In psychology, you call this projections. And we live in a world of projections. What we think about other people, but also what we think about colors or forms. We think, we look at a painting and we really look at something new. Something that triggers in our mind a resonance. It might be an image of a kitchen or a person or a mustache or something. But it triggers something in us. And then we like it or dislike it. That like or dislike is therefore not real. It's a projection. It's a resonance between what we are and what is out there. And in fact, nearly everything we do and everything we perceive is based on those projections and the responses we have to that, because we think that the other person is that or that. It would help at times to think about people around you like a mirror. And in the old Vedic tradition, you would say, thou art that. You are what is around you. Falling in love. We all know the feeling, or at least I hope you know the feeling of falling in love. Now, many books are written about love and what it means. But for me, falling in love is meeting someone and going back to the inner child, to my soul, myself, that was inside me and is hidden behind me. So when I meet a person, and by chance, or because the stars are there, or I just had a nice drink, or the music that plays, I am in that inner child state, that I feel myself. And I meet another person who is in that state, both of us feel suddenly recognized. We see each other's inner child. And that is what people call chemistry. We are in that state. Suddenly everything works. The right music, the right people, the right environment, everything works. We are in love. For me, that means being in that inner child state. Two people. Now, sometimes that lasts a few minutes, sometimes that lasts a few days, sometimes a few weeks, and I know people where it lasted a lifetime. That's great. They always see each other in that inner child, which is the pure us inside, something we hide to the normal world. But most of the times we lose it. And what we do then, we just put on our mask again. We hide our inner child and become the programs and the behavioral patterns that makes up our personality, our ego. So for me, falling in love is going to my inner child state. It can happen with people, it can happen with a painting, it can happen with music, but it's a wonderful, nice experience. It's something we should go back to. And I think in the Bible it says that Christ said, go to the realm of children if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven. Well, being in love is the kingdom of heaven, and you have to go to your inner child. You have probably heard about the problem of our graying society. We grow older. Not enough kids are born, at least in the Western world, but also in China. And one could say that very, very slowly the world population is becoming in a balance. But that means in the West we have a problem, a growing problem with people growing older. Now, there is a tendency, especially among the generation that kind of remembers the 60s and the idea of communities, that they want to live in a community. And that's a very good idea, especially when you grow older. But I noticed that many people talk about this communities as something they want to do to the world. They said, we want to have a permaculture farm, or we want to have a place where we can help others, or we have a want to have a center for spiritual help or psychotherapy or massage. And they're still looking out towards the world. It's like they're looking for an excuse to form a community. Well, sorry to say, I think the main purpose of people, older people like me, looking for community is that we want to die in a nice environment with our friends, taken care of. So the purpose of senior communities should be clearly stated, I think. A place to die in peace and with friends and help. Forget about all these excuses. Forget about all these grand ideas. These are ideas about helping the world. But if we're really honest to ourselves, we're trying to help ourselves. And if you think about a community, look for something where that is clear. That it is about helping yourself. Then at least you're honest to yourself. And if you're honest to yourself, you can be honest to others. Which is part of the secret of life. So, if you want to die in a nice environment with nice people, be clear about it. Jewelry. Decorations of your body. Diamonds, crystals, stones, gold, silver. What does it do? Well, to be honest, I think all these external symbols fortify that what you are. So if you're very rich, wear a lot of diamonds. You'll stay rich. If you're very powerful, show it by wearing all these things. There are maybe more reasons, but one of the reasons is that they keep you in your ego. The energy that you gave to those jewels, crystals, diamonds, keeps you in what you are. In daily life, your personality. It keeps you away from change. It solidifies your situation. Now, if you're rich, that's a very good way to stay rich. But we all know that being rich does not necessarily mean being happy. And that change in this lifetime is what makes you progress, what makes you more aware. So, wear a lot of jewelry and you stay as you are. You will stay in your mask, you will stay in your personality and your ego, and you will not change much. Going to the world without anything is the best way. That's how we came into the world and probably how we will go away. So, all this is only there to keep you stuck. And if you don't want to get stuck, change. And do away with all these external symbols. They do have other purposes, but this is just one. Jewelry, and in fact, all external symbols, they are like a prison. They imprison your personality. They bring you into that safe environment where you feel like, oh yes, this is me. Well, excuse me, it's not you. It's your mask, it's your ego, and it's not you. It's not the inner self, it's not the inner child. So, if you want to free the inner child, don't wear jewelry. Gold. On my hand, I have a nugget. A nugget is a piece of gold as it is found in nature. Now, gold is a very important material because I think it influences brain waves. It shields you from brain waves. It can reflect or deflect brain waves. But why is that? Well, I actually think that it's not the gold, but it's one of the isotopes of gold. Now, you know that many elements have isotopes. Uranium is very well known. It has one that radiates more than the other, and it's used to create atomic power plants and use that energy. Gold has 17 isotopes. They're all radioactive except the first one. That's what we normally see as gold. But here I have a crystal. And in crystal, the isotopes that are radioactive and therefore would fall apart normally is contained. That's why we have uranium-238 in nature, because in the crystal it's not falling apart, it's not degrading, it's not radiating anything. Otherwise, after 5 billion years of Earth, there would be no uranium-238. Now, it is this specific isotope of gold that is so important, because that is very closely related to, for instance, quicksilver or lead. And I think that isotope is indeed what the alchemists were looking for. It is the psychoactive component of gold, you could say. Psychoactive, as in it has a relationship with that dimension we call information or thoughts or ideas. So, isotopes of gold, and especially the one you will find in nuggets, are important. I think the alchemists were actually trying to take that one isotope out of it. But of course, if they would use old gold, it didn't work. If they would use new gold found in nature with the crystal. So based on this, I think that nuggets, gold that's found in nature in a crystalline form, which contains this isotope, is the most powerful substance. It's both a crystal and a metal, and it has this one special gold isotope. Gold, in that sense, is a substance that has value beyond its chemical or physical nature, because we use it also to shield things, electricity, it is a very good, it connects very well, it doesn't degrade, it doesn't oxidize. But apart from that, gold is important as something that relates to that information dimension. And I think the first isotope of gold, the first, and it's a radioactive isotope, is the one that's most important. Evolution. Evolution is a remembrance of the future. Now, that's a strange statement, because it implies that we, in one way, are knowing the future, or that the seed that becomes a tree knows its future. Evolution is a remembrance of the future. And I think DNA plays a role in that. I would call it the antenna into the future. As we now know that DNA plays an important role, but that's only the 20% that we kind of know. The rest is like what we call junk DNA. And I think in that junk DNA, there is actually this function of feeling, sensing, or it's called knowing the future. And since that is like knowing the past, I call it remembrance. Remembering the future. Now, this is a very important notion, but because it implies that everything in nature, but especially live things, have a contact with the future. That through the DNA, we, but also the plants and all life forms, can sense the future. This idea will really change the way we think about the future. It has far-ranging implications. But take this as the core idea. Evolution is remembering the future. The seed knows where it's going. It also implies we could, at some level, know the future. Now, of course, that's very hard. We're not in close contact with our DNA. We filter the information that might come in through our thoughts, through our emotions, through our memories. But maybe some of us know the future too. And if I read the holy books, take the Bible, the Quran, they're all full with stories about prophets, people remembering the future and telling about it, sometimes with a big effect, because they change the course of history, they say, a war or something. Evolution is remembering the future. And that means that time moves in two ways, that we can or could know the future. And I'm certain that the seed that grows into a plant or a tree knows the future. That's how he grows. We live in what people call the information age. And that sounds as if there is total freedom. Information wants to be free. We can know everything. The problem is that also the government wants to know everything. And the people that want your money, the hackers. And so in our time, the issue of security versus freedom, of security versus privacy, is a very important one. Now, usually this is seen as a balance. If the security goes up, your privacy, your freedom goes down. And that's how the government brings it to us. They say, oh yeah, yeah, more freedom after 9/11. Sorry, more security. So less freedom. If you go to the airport now, we have to search you, we know your data, we find out where you are, we check you, we monitor your behavior, and we even profile you. Now, I believe that this balance is the wrong image. And therefore, I go back to Plato. Plato had an image that he said, the mind, the psyche, has to control two horses. A wild horse, freedom, and a tame horse, a good horse, security. According to Plato, it was the task of the psyche to kind of control both of them, make them go in the same direction. Now, if we take those two horses to be also in society, freedom versus security, the wild horse, the tame horse, that's fine. But I just want to add a little bit to Plato's image from the Phaedrus. That's where he wrote that. And it is that behind the driver, the psyche, or in this case, the lawmaker or the boss, is a cart. And in the cart are the stakeholders. And I believe that if we think about freedom versus security, we should think about what the stakeholders want. And then the boss, the lawmaker, the judge, has to balance those two. And they're not opposing each other. They go into the same direction. But it is his job or her job to find out how to steer them towards the goal that the stakeholders make. And that's a different way of looking at this dilemma of freedom versus security. Religion, belief systems. Many religions have become more of a social structure. But originally they were all concerned with the metaphysical, the unseen, the other world. Today, most of the old religions are classified as, you know, old-fashioned, unrational, no proof. Something that you can have in your mind but has no real significance in the real world. Well, I think they do. Religions are very important because they bring that relationship with the other world that we lost. And think about it. In the old days, our purpose was to be happy in this world and in the afterworld. We lost that. So we're now left with the one goal in life is to be happy in this world. Well, that means money, power, pleasure, all those material things. But what about the afterlife, the next thing? If we don't think about it, if we don't think about the other metaphysical, then we don't need values, norms, beyond the very, you know, the very flat thing that if I hurt you, I hurt myself, because this is the basis of what we call the le contrat social, or the social contract. No, if we don't have an afterlife, we don't have to live good in our own mind. That's what is missing. Since a few hundred years, we're losing that concept of the afterlife, of the other world, of the contact with the other world. We lose religion. And because of that, we are stuck in a material, selfish world. So when we talk about the financial crisis, and when we talk about the bank crisis and how bad the big companies are, we're really talking about something that's related to the loss of our connection with the other world, with the metaphysical. Call it God, call it information, call it love, call it afterlife. Doesn't matter. We've lost it. And I think that is the main problem in our world today, that we're only looking at the reality we can measure, perceive. But we lose track and we lose a contact with that which cannot be seen and what is out there after, for instance, after we die. Religions. The religions we know best in the West are the Judaic and the Christian traditions. Now, what is the Christian tradition? Now, it's of course centered on love and on the heart. In Eastern terms, you could say it is centered on the heart chakra. And look at the symbolism. Human sacrifice, I mean, Christ died. The heart, blood, bread and wine, blood. So it's all related to the heart chakra. I think religion are actually related, as a general indication, to those chakras. Take Judaism, and therefore also Islam. It is really centered around the throat chakra. Things. It's about praying. It's about using your voice to honor the other world, to honor God, Allah, with a lot of rules, because this chakra also controls the hands and what you do in the world. It's actually the throat chakra connection to being in the world, acting in the world. So these religions are full with rules, with constraints, what you should do and what you not do. They don't want you to visualize. They don't want you to see images, graven images, or images, painted images. Actually, in Islam, that is a no-go. It's a taboo. You should not see things. But you should concentrate on being there. Now, maybe you noticed, but when we pray in the Western world, we do it like that. If we pray in the Muslim world, we pray like that. We read the book. This is the heart, and this is of course reading the book, the rules. The Quran is the most holy gift from Allah. There are other chakras with their concentration on religious issues. Take for instance the stomach, the power. That is something that has to do with power in the world. And the Hindus see power, truth, as the most important thing. Love is less important in Hinduism. It's about being knowledgeable, it's about being powerful. And if you think about Buddhism, where visualization is so important, that's kind of centered around this chakra. And of course there are other chakras. We have the tantric chakra, the sexual, we have here something like a very deep connection to the divine, And Sufism could be there, but there are other religions or traditions. And in the bottom we have animism, where we are very much related to earth. Our number one chakra is our connection to air, wind, the nature forces. So I believe religions are related to the energies in our body. They are a reflection of the energy centers that we could call chakras. So if there was no Christianity, there would be a religion that had to do with the heart chakra. Maybe we wouldn't call it Christianity, but it would still have the same forms and symbols. Do you ever see spooks, ghosts, feel strange energy? Many people do. Now, I believe that for a large part that is their fantasy. I believe that any object in space, and some more than others, will pick up the energy of what happens around it. So if you touch something, or even if you like a certain jewelry, you wear it a long time, that object takes on the energy of what happens to it. So objects have a memory. And there are sensitive people that can sense that. They can say, oh, this stone has been with this person, whatever. And even if there's a place where an accident happened once, people will go to say, oh, I feel something. And it's even more likely that another accident will happen there. So there are energy eddies, little wirbles here and there. But what are spooks? Ghosts. This is when sensitive people who feel these energies don't know what to do with them or project on them their own fears and their own imagination and their own ideas. And maybe you realize that in the old days, if some kids out there in Lourdes met some of these energies, they projected Maria on it. Today, many people, when they meet these energies, these vortices, they will say, oh, there was a UFO, and come up with fantastic stories. They were, in fact, in contact with the truth, with some deeper truth that lies beyond what we can measure. But what they then did is they put their projection, they had to give it a human form to make it tangible. And since we have heard about ghosts and spirits, it's quite easy to say, oh, out there in the garden is a ghost. But what in fact happens is that people lay over the factual energy that is there, which we as yet cannot really measure. Some people can feel it, we put a human-like, humanoid image over it. Whether it be a ghost or a UFO or a saint or Maria. But this is what our mind does. We take a little signal out there, a little energy wirble, and make it into something we can grasp, we can handle. So I don't believe in spooks, I don't believe in ghosts, I don't believe in apparitions, but I do believe in energy, and that matter contains energies and contains also the information from the past. A bit is only information if it bites. I say it again, a bit is only information if it bites. Of course, this is a play on words, you know, bits, and 8 bits make a byte, and information is all about bits and bytes. But what it really says is that something, a little signal that's out there between you and me, or between anything, only becomes information if it changes something, if it has an effect. If it bites. Now that's a very important distinction, because we have the internet and it's a mountain of data. And it's becoming bigger and bigger. The World Wide Web is one big mine full of data. But to make it information, you have to dig into it. You have to mine that data for that little piece that you need at that specific moment. And we have search engines, and there's many, many ways to get information out of that enormous mass of data. We have data highways, but we have no information highways. In fact, the information highway that we have is here. It's our mind, which is even bigger than our brains. That's our connection to the information that is everywhere. Because it's not only the internet and the World Wide Web and the computers that contain data and therefore maybe information, but all around is information. One could even say that information is the basic thing that holds everything together. In physical terms, information is related to resonance. And the new physics teaches us that to make that clear, you need an observer to measure that resonance. And that resonance is the basis of reality. So a bit is only information if it bytes. Not only applies to computers, it applies to everything. Information is what connects everything. Resonance is what connects everything. And some people would say, but that's magical. Yes, it is magical, because we cannot really measure it. We can see only the effect when the bit bytes. Something happens in you, in the world. There is a change. Something happens. If nothing happens, it is just noise. We call that noise. Then nothing happens. You can look at your computer and knowing there is 16 gigabytes or 16 terabytes of data in there, but by just like looking at it, nothing happens. Only when it becomes information, it might become on the screen, or you might find what you're looking for. That's one problem. You'll find what you're looking for. You might not find what you need. And that is the basic problem of our information age. Does it bring you what you need? Or does it only bring you what you're looking for?